automotive industry has seen a lot of changes in recent years. More and more robots are replacing workers on the assembly line. And it isn't just cars and trucks coming off the line anymore. Today's Hot Wheels are sport utility vehicles and vans. In the plant's body shop, they begin by putting together the front structure of the van. It's made up of the radiator support, two side rails, and clips on the front of those side rails for the bumper structure. Then they put this front structure onto the automated production line. Meanwhile, robots weld what's known as the ladder assembly. It's the backbone that supports the floor and sides of the van. It contains, among other things, the pockets that will hold the seats. Now the robots take the front end structure and the ladder assembly and weld them together. Elsewhere, robots work on the body panel for the passenger side of the van. The entire panel is made of one piece of galvanized steel. The robots weld reinforcements onto the panel so they can later attach interior finishing and other components. A transfer device swoops down and transfers the panel to the next station. The driver's side body panel, coming off another welding line, is headed there too. At that next station, robots have already installed an underbody with a floor panel on top of the ladder assembly unit we saw earlier. Now the robots weld the body side panels to the underbody. They also weld inner wheel wells to the body side panels. Then they weld on a roof. The van then rolls into the area of the body shop called closures. The engines arrive at the plant already assembled. Workers just have to install and adjust a few components. Meanwhile, the van is off at the paint shop and then goes to the trim shop for glass, handles, and interior components. In the chassis department, the engine, transmission, rear suspension, and brake assembly are installed from underneath. This part of the assembly line has two tiers. The van goes on top, the components on the bottom. The machines that install the components have long pins that fit into holes in the van's underbody. This positions the components with precision. Workers hook up the gas tank manually. The seats arrive ready-made from a nearby factory. They simply clamp into place in the seat pockets that were welded onto the ladder assembly earlier. An automated machine mates the tire to the wheel rim. Then it inflates and balances the tire. Workers mount the tires, starting the nuts by hand, then tightening them with tools. Now the van comes off the carrier and goes full weight on its wheels for the first time. Workers start up the ignition and run the van through a series of tests. It's taken the plant about 24 hours to produce this vehicle, which will soon be on its way to a car dealership.
Steelmaking usually begins with a pile of scrap metal. Using this 10-ton electromagnet, scrap iron, composed of crushed car bodies, electric appliances, cans, and other steel scraps are gathered up. This powerful magnet is able to lift 5 tons of metal. About 83% of this scrap will be transformed into bars of steel. This metal is then dumped into a basket, which, by itself, weighs 32 tons. The basket can hold up to 60 tons of metal, and now they're going to melt the metal. This furnace reaches a temperature of 1650 degrees centigrade, hot enough to liquefy the metal. It is heated by 3 electrodes and by 4 natural gas burners. The contents of the basket are dumped into the furnace. Here, the pieces of metal come into contact with liquefied steel, which always remains at the bottom of the furnace. There's a reaction, and an aeration system draws out the smoke that's produced. At this high heat, the 60 tons of metal will melt in about 60 minutes. Then the cover is placed on the furnace. This liquid is composed of impurities, which rise to the surface when the metal becomes molten. At this stage, a workman draws a sample of steel to determine its chemical makeup. And now they make use of a supersonic oxygen lance. This lance blows oxygen into the molten steel, which reduces its carbon content, homogenizes the mix, and then speeds up the melting process. A ladle is positioned beneath the furnace. The molten steel will be transferred from the furnace into this ladle. The molten steel easily pours into the ladle. The ladle weighs 55 tons and holds 115 tons of molten steel. An overhead crane capable of lifting 180 tons carries the ladle filled with steel. Additives are introduced in order to obtain the correct steel tone. Here, the electrodes are taken out of the furnace ladle. A workman now opens the pouring nozzles of the distributor, equipped with 4 pouring holes. The molten steel runs into molds. It very quickly cools and begins to harden. Steel billets are produced in lengths varying between 4.5 meters and 10.6 meters. The billets are then cut to the desired length with a natural gas torch. A pouring identification number is marked on them with a wax crayon. The difference between a steel billet and the nearly finished flattened product is clear. Flattening of the billets remains to be done. At the end of production, bars move along at a speed reaching 35 kilometers per hour. Once reaching their required dimensions, the bars must be cooled. This cooling bed allows the steel bars to cool uniformly. A total of some 400,000 tons of steel bars are made at this plant each year.
There are two types of scrap metal, ferrous and non-ferrous. Ferrous scrap is scrap iron and steel that comes mainly from old cars. Non-ferrous scrap metal includes aluminum, copper, lead, and nickel. And the best part is, metals can be recycled indefinitely without losing any of their properties. Each year, North American auto plants build millions of cars. Eventually, they end up here at a scrap metal recycling facility. It takes about 2 days to process the raw material, mostly old cars and appliances. Crane and bulldozer operators scan the raw material as they gather and stack it. They're looking for anything they can't process: propane tanks, glass, or heavy iron that will not shred and that could cause damage to the machinery. An inspector goes into the stockpile to check the material more closely, then signals the crane operator that he can proceed with the next load. The crane's grapple delivers load after load onto a conveyor belt that leads into a shredder. The belt speeds up or slows down according to the weight of the material to feed just the right amount into the shredder. Here's the feed box that contains the shredder laid open. An inspector checks it daily for damage. There's a lot of wear and tear on this machinery. An 1,800 kilogram drum grabs the material as it comes off the conveyor and forces it into the shredder. Its giant hammers pound away at the cars, mattresses, and other recyclable items, shredding them into fist-sized chunks. An industrial vacuum sucks out bits of rubber or glass mixed in with the shredded steel. The steel pieces stick to these magnetic drums. Anything else falls through to a conveyor belt below. Here, pickers remove any unwanted material caught on the steel pieces, and the cleaned, shredded steel is ready for shipping to customers like steel mills and foundries.
The material the magnetic drums don't collect goes on for more processing. There's precious non-ferrous metal, such as copper or brass, mixed in with the shredded debris. It all goes into a machine called a trommel, where a rotating drum separates the material by size. Any leftover residue is just trash. But before it goes into a landfill, an inspector checks it to make sure no valuable material has slipped through. The material from the trommel is evenly dispersed onto a conveyor that takes it to a machine called an eddy current separator. Inside, a rotating magnetic drum creates a strong magnetic field that repels non-ferrous metals right up and over a barrier into a storage bin. Any material that doesn't make it over the barrier goes through the separator one more time, just in case there's still some valuable non-ferrous metals mixed in. A conveyor belt carries out the worthless residue to a trash heap. A different conveyor belt carries the non-ferrous metal out of the separator and loads it into a bin for sale. It will go to another plant where they'll separate it by type of metal, mainly copper, brass, and aluminum. After all that shredding, sifting, and separating, here's what's left of the average used car. Take away the rubber, plastic, and upholstery, and you have some shredded steel and some valuable non-ferrous metals. That's a lot of useful material, thanks to some efficient recycling.
You've properly prepared, sorted, and bagged your recyclables and have put them to the curb on your recycling day. You might be wondering what happens to your recyclables from there. Who picks them up? Where do they go? And what are they made into? City of St. John's recycling collection trucks are in your neighborhood every second week to pick up your properly sorted recyclables. Papers go in one bag, containers in another, because these bags end up in different compartments on the recycling trucks. It may look like the bags are all just going into the truck, but inside there's a wall that keeps paper on one side and containers on the other. When they are full or finished collecting recyclables for the day, City of St. John's recycling trucks head to the Robin Hood Bay Waste Management Facility. All trucks bringing waste to Robin Hood Bay, whether recyclables or garbage, are weighed first. After they dump their waste, they're weighed again on the way out. This is how we know how much garbage and recycling is coming into Robin Hood Bay. After a recycling truck is weighed in, it heads to the recycling facility where the bags of recyclables are tipped out of the truck and deposited onto the tipping floor. From here, the bags are pushed onto the recyclables processing line by a front-end loader.
Thank you.